In the last lecture, you were introduced to Marin factors. We did that because we're really trying to sort out on the logarithmic chart where we have number of cycles to failure. We have these regimes at 10 to the third and 10 to the sixth, and we have a slope in the low cycle fatigue regime that connects the FSUT to the 10 to the third cycles, and we can anchor that 10 to the third cycles using some fraction of the ultimate tensile strength. And we have to look that fraction up. And then we have the endurance limit down here, SE prime, below which fatigue strength associated with that endurance limit is such that you have infinite number of cycles to failure. And there is another straight line that connects those two points, and that is the high cycle fatigue regime. And this is the infinite life regime out here. And you want to know whether or not you do have an infinite life. And if you can keep your fatigue strength below that SE prime so that you'll have infinite life. And you also want to be able to predict the number of cycles to failure in the high cycle fatigue regime. And in that high cycle fatigue regime, you know that the fatigue strength is equal to some constant times the number of cycles to failure raised to the power B. And you can find these constants A and B if you know the endurance strength and if you know F times the ultimate tensile strength. We spend a lot of time discussing what this endurance strength is. And we have noted that we want to correct that endurance strength using these Marin factors. And we have already talked about factors KA and KB. Now, again, I want to emphasize what we are trying to do is convert this SE prime to an SE so that we can properly anchor the location of the fatigue strength at 10 to the 6 cycles to failure. Once we have that for our given component, we could use Basquin's law to determine the number of cycles to failure within the high cycle fatigue regime. In the last lecture, we introduced the surface modification factor, Ka, and we said that it was two constants, A and B, that are used in this equation that relates the surface correction factor to the ultimate tensile strength. We also introduced equation 620, which have to do with the geometric size effect, and we have diameter ranges for fully reversed bending in here for either metric or English units, and the equations that are to be used. We want to deal with KC, KD, KE from here on out, and take note of the fact that KF is some miscellaneous factors that will affect fatigue lifetime. Don't worry about those right now. So the next thing that comes up is loading type. So if we have fully reversed bending, as you know, we take a bar, we have an axis of rotation, we expose it to a bending moment, and that creates fully reversed cyclic loading so that if we looked at the stress amplitude, it would look something like this. It would vary in a nice, beautiful cyclic manner. Well, what if we change the loading type? What if instead of bending, we take the same bar and we expose it to cyclic tension? What you can notice right off the bat is that the volume of material that is sampled by this cyclic load at high stress levels is going to be much larger than the volume of material that's sampled by rotating bending at the same stress levels. So you would expect that when you move to tensile loading, you're going to have to knock down the endurance limit. What about if we have cyclic torsion instead of bending? Again, you would expect that you would have to modify the endurance limit. And in fact, the loading factor modifications are shown here in equation 626, where we do no modification if it's in bending. That's what we develop all of this fatigue analysis from, bending load. So you don't want to modify the endurance limit. If you move to axial loads, you multiply by a factor of 0.85 because you have to knock down the endurance limit and you knock it down even more. Keep in mind, this is pure bending, pure axial loading, and pure torsion. So you have to be careful about that. When we develop our understanding of endurance strength, it was all tabulated for fully reversed bending and at room temperature on polished specimens. And so these Marin factors are converting the ideal test conditions into actual service conditions. And it turns out there will be a temperature effect also on the endurance strength. And so we are going to modify the endurance strength using a temperature correction factor, KD. The way we understand this is that if we take the ultimate tensile strength and divide it by the ultimate tensile strength at room temperature, where room temperature is about 20 degrees C or 70 degrees F, then we find that as we increase the temperature, these are in degrees C in this particular graph, the ultimate tensile strength ratio goes up and then it comes down as the temperature gets really large. The yield strength is constantly going down. And so we have to account for the fact that the ultimate tensile strength is changing. And you may also recall that we estimate SE prime as 1/2 the ultimate tensile strength. What we can do is the following. If we want to estimate SE prime, then we can do that by taking this graphical relationship, which relates the ultimate strength at temperature to the ultimate strength at room temperature. This thing becomes our temperature correction factor. So if we know the strength at room temperature, then we can estimate the strength at any other temperature simply by modifying the room temperature strength. We have two approaches that we can take when we solve problems and do temperature corrections. We can either find the corrected ultimate strength using a relationship between the ratio of the strengths to the temperature, or we can just directly calculate KD and modify the endurance limit by knocking it down or raising it up, depending upon where we are on this curve. Table 6.4 gives a listing of the strength ratios. So these are the temperature effects on the ultimate tensile strengths for degrees C here and degrees F over here. We can also take that curve of the ratio of the strength to the room temperature strength and fit it with a polynomial function that looks like this. And we can then use that function for any temperature to calculate the effective KD. So let's go ahead and work out a problem to see how we can do this. So we're going to look at a 1035 steel that has a tensile strength of 70 kpsi and is used for a part that sees 450 degrees Fahrenheit in service. It says first estimate the Marin temperature modification factor and the endurance limit under two conditions. First, condition A, the room temperature endurance limit is given, so that SE prime at 70 degrees is equal to 39 kpsi. So what we're going to do in this case is we're going to find the SE at 450 degrees Fahrenheit by multiplying this SE prime by the temperature correction factor. To do this, we're going to use equation 627, where we're simply going to insert for TF 450 degrees Fahrenheit. That will allow us to calculate KD. If we do that, we find that KD is 1.007. So SE at 450 degrees Fahrenheit is 1.007 times 39 kpsi. That's the endurance limit at room temperature. And if we multiply that out, we get 39.27 kpsi. So our endurance limit has gone up as we move from room temperature to 450 degrees Fahrenheit. And I told you that certainly could happen. Once we have this KD, the other thing that we could do, so what we could do is we could take the ratio of the ultimate tensile strengths and set that equal to KD. We know the KD is 1.007. So the ultimate tensile strength at 450 degrees Fahrenheit is going to be equal to 1.007 times the ultimate tensile strength at room temperature. And we have said that the ultimate tensile strength up here is 70 kpsi. So we multiply that by 70 kpsi. That gives us an SUT at 450 degrees Fahrenheit of 70.5 kpsi. So the estimated endurance strength would be half of that. And so we're going to say it's just equal to 35 kpsi. So this answer up here gives us a larger endurance strength than does this one down there. But, you know, if you want to stay conservative, you would use the 35 kpsi as your estimate of the endurance strength. The next thing that we must consider is reliability. This relationship where we calculate the first estimated endurance strength as half the ultimate tensile strength is based upon a bunch of data which shows a lot of scatter, which you see in here, and the relationship is for 50% reliability. So if we want higher reliability, you know that we are going to have to knock that endurance limit down. So as we increase reliability, we are going to have to decrease the endurance strength, meaning as designers, we simply have to keep our applied stress amplitude lower in order to increase the reliability of the system. So what we end up using is a reliability correction factor, KE, as a Marin factor, which is given by table 6.5 in the book. You see that if you just want 50% reliability, your factor is 1. That's something we already know. If we want higher reliabilities, you have to knock down the endurance strength by these amounts to achieve the reliabilities that are given. Okay, so the best way for us to understand this is to just do a problem. This is example 6.8 from the Shigley textbook, where it asks us to analyze a 1015 hot rolled steel bar that has been machined to a diameter of 1 inch. It's placed in reversed axial loading for 70,000 cycles to failure at a temperature of 550 degrees F. So we're going to have to use the material properties, and they also want a reliability of 99%. So we have to estimate the endurance limit and then the fatigue strength. So this means that the first thing we're going to have to do is calculate and estimate our SE prime. That's before we apply any Marin factors. Now, we go to table A20 in the book for this particular hot rolled 1015, and we find that the ultimate tensile strength is 50 kpsi. So SE is 1/2 that 50 kpsi, simply 25 kpsi. Now what we have to do is we have to decide which Marin factors we are going to use to knock this down. So we're going to be exposing this bar. It is a 1-inch diameter bar exposed to cyclic tensile loading. We have this Ka equal A SUT to the B. We have the factor KB, which is a geometric size correction factor. But for axial loading, we are loading the entire cross section, so KB is going to be equal to 1 for axial loading. We don't have to worry about calculating equivalent diameters. We don't have to worry about the geometric size correction factor. Next thing is KC. So Ka is the surface finish. We'll have to see what we're going to do about that in a moment. KB is the size correction factor. We have already said that that is equal to 1. KC is the loading correction factor. And what happens if we go from bending, where the loading correction factor is 1, to axial loading? And if we look it up, we find that it's 0.85. So to calculate KD, I need this temperature correction equation. So we have to calculate this for T equal 550 degrees Fahrenheit. Height. And at 99, you will see that I need a correction factor of 0.814. So KE is 0.814 from the table. So I'm stuck with calculating a surface finish correction factor and a temperature correction factor. The other ones I've already sorted out. To do the surface finish correction factor, I need this equation, and this is a machine sample. I'm doing my units in KPSI, so I need these two constants. I find that Ka is equal to 2.70 times the ultimate tensile strength raised to the power of minus 0.265. Now, this is important, by the way, that these factors from this table in the book associated with equation 619 assume that you are entering the ultimate tensile strength in units of KPSI or units of MPa. You got to make sure you enter them correctly. If we do enter these units in here, we can then calculate the surface finish correction factor and get a value of 0.96 for Ka. And up here for the temperature correction factor, we have to insert temperature of 550 degrees F into equation 627. If we do that, we get a value for the temperature correction factor of 0.98. So now I believe we have all the correction factors that we need. We have already said that our SE is 25, so our fully corrected endurance strength is going to be Ka, which we calculated to be 0.96. So we have 0.96 times KB, which for axial loading is equal to 1, multiplied by KC, where in axial loading it's 0.85. Multiply that by KD, which we just calculated to be 0.98. 8. We multiply that by Ke, the reliability factor, which we have already found is 0.814. Kf, we're not going to include any extra ones, so that's just 1. We multiply all of that by 25 kpsi, and we find that our fully corrected endurance strength is going to be 16.27 kpsi. Now that we know that the fully corrected endurance strength, the next thing that we have to do, estimate the endurance limit and fatigue strength at 70,000 cycles. So we're moving into the HCF regime at NF equals 70,000 cycles. So we're going to want to use the relationship between fatigue strength and the number of cycles to failure. So we have to find these new constants, A and B, so we can calculate the fatigue strength for 70,000 cycles. We have these fitting equations, so we need this factor F. And the way we find that factor F is from the relationship between F and the ultimate tensile strength. We already looked up in table A20 that our ultimate tensile strength was 50 kpsi. That is below 70 on this chart, so we just use F equals 0.9. We have our ultimate tensile strength being equal to 50 kpsi, and we calculated our endurance limit to be 16.3 kpsi. So that means we can find A and B. And that gives us a value of 124, and it has the units of kps. For B, it's going to be equal to 0.-0.147. So we now have what we need to find SF. Well, the fatigue strength, that's 70,000 cycles, is going to be 124 kpsi multiplied by that 70,000 cycles raised to the power minus 0.147. I get a fatigue strength of 24 kpsi. That's how you go through with all of these Marin factors and find relationships in the high cycle fatigue regime.